This is Sosuke Aizen from Bleach. Remember to like and subscribe to James Hansen. Do it now, or you'll regret it.
Okay, so, hey everybody, with the Bleach anime coming very soon to our doorsteps. We don't have a release date yet, but it is coming soon. I thought it was only appropriate that I speak to the man, the myth, the legend, that is Carl Haber, and his role with Aizen Sosuke. So, Aizen, before we start this, I gotta ask, was the Bleach anime's return all a part of your plan?
It was. It was all part of the plan.
You had to do the voice. I love it.
Of course. I could talk like Aizen the whole interview if you wish.
Yeah, I might fanboy, but hey, you do you.
That's okay. I'll keep you on your toes. I'll just start randomly going into different characters for no reason.
Right, if I go silent, it's because I'm screaming inside of like fanboying. It's all good. So, I have to throw it in there. With the Bleach anime being announced, how did you react to it? How did you see the news? Like, can you give me, like, just give me your thoughts and reactions to that? I mean, obviously you're happy because, you know, you could have a potential new job.
Potential new job. Yeah, yeah. That and that, of course, the big question is, when are you going to dub it? And the answer is, we don't know when. We have to know if, because it does have to be licensed, and they have to be willing to do a dub, and they have to be willing to bring everyone back. And if they do that, they jump through those hoops, I'm right here waiting. So yeah, as soon as I heard the news, it's like, it was a little bit shocking too, because I thought for sure they would have done this by the 10th anniversary. I mean, that would have been a nice little cherry on top.
Oh, for sure, yeah.
But when that came and went, I mean, you're like, oh, what are they going to do now? I mean, there's no incentive. As time goes on and on and on and on, people will move on.
And there's a lot of shows that are coming back recently, which is very surprising. So things are taking a different turn, to say the least. So, like, how did you find out about it? Like, when it was announced, did you find out through Twitter? Did you find out through the live stream, through Shonen Jump?
Twitter, actually. Twitter? I'm most active on Twitter and Instagram. Yeah, I love social media. I love being able to get the instant pulse of people around the world and what they're talking about. And you know, news travels obviously a lot faster than even when Bleach first hit. You know, the internet was just starting to be a thing, and social media wasn't even out yet.
I noticed the big boom was around about 2012 when streaming platforms became more prevalent, I would say.
Yeah, and it became a whole transition in the business model, because at first the internet was the big enemy because people were pirating and bootlegging, and several studios in Japan went under. But now it's starting to shift with studios in Japan kind of accepting that, okay, we got to give the people what they want, because there's this element that will always pirate, but if we can get the product out there as quick as possible, officially subtitled, or license the dub in a much faster, so there's a shorter window of waiting, then we can serve our audiences and we can still, you know, make money, which anime is a business, and they need the money to churn out to keep making the shows we want. So
absolutely. And one of the questions is going to be about that said topic, so we will come back to that because it's very fascinating to me specifically. As Bleach wasn't back and there was that whole years of uncertainty, there was a few people from my fandom that had been seeing a lot of panels from you specifically and many other cast members alongside with you, and there was a guy that told me that you was alluding to a lot of Bleach's return, very much so in like 2018 or 19. Did you in fact actually have an idea, or did you know, or was it just logical to you?
I just kind of had a feeling in my gut that maybe the studios over in Japan were probably playing with that idea, because you can't ignore how huge that show has been in around the world, especially in North America, and of course back in its country. But and you're seeing things like studios, big movie studios like Warner Brothers, purchasing the live action rights. Not that they'll necessarily do anything with it, but when you have this going on, it's kind of
put
interesting.
Put it on the shelf.
Yeah. I mean, you got Netflix that greenlit a live action Cowboy Bebop, and people are worried about that. But you know, John Cho's a great actor, and I'm interested to see what they can do.
I think it's understandable, but many people will always be skeptical until the product eventually does come out, but until then we're always going to be left in the loop as a fandom, and we always want the best for it, so I feel like the intentions are always good.
Yeah, and whatever medium it comes out on, there's always going to be a people, an element of the audience that'll always say, oh yeah, well I like the movie but the book's so much better, or you know, I like the movie was okay, or the movie totally wrong because the original source material in the manga and the anime was totally different. And yeah, I kind of feel like anime should remain anime. I get the salivating that the studios can see more money if we can reach people that don't normally watch it. I understand. But more often than not, and I'm sure you'll agree, that the translations into these other mediums have been, their success rate's not so high.
I think they should have got you to narrate the Dragon Ball live action movie, to be honest, man.
Hey.
Maybe it would have gave it a bit more better.
Yeah. I mean, it's not the worst movie ever made, but it is an awful translation of the source material. And I did remember, I called Funimation and I said, can you reach out to 20th Century Fox and say, hey, we got the narrator here if you want him for the movie trailer at least or something. But Fox says, nope, we want nothing to do with the original. We're taking this.
Of course I do. Yeah.
And we see how well that worked.
Yeah, abysmally. You, as far as you've told me, you've not read the manga. You're completely out of the loop with this, right?
Correct.
So, are you So I want to tell you some spoilers, but I'm not going to. But are you excited about your role potentially within the next coming season?
Yes, I'm more excited about just having closure for the series, because at this point it's going to be a hard sell to people who've never watched Bleach, because they know that when they finish all the seasons, it just ends and there's no real ending. You have to read the manga to get the true ending, and I think people that want to recommend Bleach to those who haven't seen it yet, they might want to hold on to that recommendation and wait until this final arc comes out and then say, okay, now watch Bleach from beginning to end. And hopefully you'll be able to say that. And even the last arc's in English too, hopefully. And they got the same cast back.
Do you feel like that was the same with Dragon Ball? Do you think that was a completely different context? Because obviously with Super coming out, they started doing the Kai versions, didn't they? And obviously you was involved in that.
Yeah.
Do you feel like marketing needs to be on point? Or do you think something like Dragon Ball sells itself? It doesn't really need the marketing push in comparison to maybe Bleach?
Yeah. I think Dragon Ball's such a juggernaut it's just one of those tentpole franchises that never really goes away, even though every year since we dubbed those shows, there'd be at least one new video game title. And that was helping keep it alive. And then, yeah, it's newer generations of people growing up, and their first exposure is to things like Dragon Ball Z Abridged, which is hilarious stuff. It's like free advertising for the original show.
Absolutely.
And so there's this whole new element of people checking out Dragon Ball Z because they want to see the original context of that animation. So, yeah, that's something that never went away. And I know that there's hardcore fandom for everything in pop culture, and that's great. The fans drive what we see, especially with that connecting tissue of social media. The studios are watching. What does the audience want?
They're watching, yeah. Well, you'd like to think that, especially. I mean, some companies don't, but,
yeah.
You know, hey-ho, there you go. So, actually, I didn't write this question down, actually, but I'm very interested. How would you, per se, if it's not as the same level as Dragon Ball, which I think everyone can agree with, because that was international to the wazoo, what would you do personally to market Bleach before its anime rerun? Would you say, let's have another, like, a Dragon Ball Kai version of Bleach? Would you say, do reruns on TV, get us a video game? What would you say would be the best transition into getting a new audience to get prepared for?
I think doing a Kai version, a condensed version, minus all the filler arcs, which, the bane of most fans' existence. I mean, it's great in terms of work, because it still has to be dubbed. And, like, yeah.
I mean, luckily for you, you didn't have to do any of the filler episodes, did you?
No, I was called in for, like, bit parts. You know.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Like side characters and whatnot?
Yeah. That's actually a lot of what my career is. I get called in to do, like, the background voices and stuff, because...
Because as far as I was aware, you just had Ganju and Aizen, right?
Yeah, as far as the bigger characters. And even then, you know, Aizen's
so
the main villain.
You'll potentially have two characters to voice act.
Well, yeah. I mean, last we saw Ganju, he was in a convenience store, yeah?
Well, I ain't saying nothing.
Uh-oh.
I ain't saying nothing.
Well, you know, I think Ganju Shiba, he needs to come on back here from the West Rukon District, and maybe his hog will be, Bonnie, will be in tow.
There's unfortunately no Barney. I'm sorry. There's no Barney. But I love it though. It's great. So, from your perspective, from events, fan meetups, expos, do you, because you're mostly known for like Gohan and obviously the narrator of Dragon Ball and many such other series, My Hero, etc. Do you feel like Aizen or Ganju have been, how do I say, have they been requested from you on the same level? Do you feel like since Bleach is ending that fandom's kind of died down? Do you get asked a lot about Bleach or your characters that you played in them?
Yeah, well, people will pick up autograph prints of my Bleach characters. The most common one still is Dragon Ball, so that's kind of in its own category. But I am surprised over the past, golly, I've been doing this for 20 years now. I've been going to the convention scenes, and there's always fans that come up and represent like the stuff that's not quite as well known or as well known yet. And yeah, there's still a large contingency of fans that have come, oh, before COVID anyway, the convention scene would come up and say, "Oh, you're Aizen," and they freak out, or they get a print and. Or they see the convention banner that has Aizen on it. It's like, you were Aizen? You were Kiba Naruto? You were Gohan? And it's like, wow.
And that's great, right?
Oh my gosh,
like, would you prefer that? Like the surprise in comparison
I love
to
that.
Someone already knowing? Yeah.
It's very, very sweet, very humbling, and just adorable to see
so
people
that, so
freak
that's
out.
The interesting thing. Like, you've been doing this for 20 years, right?
Yeah.
So you've been there, you've been going to the cons during Bleach's heights,
yeah,
essentially, or its peak, so to say. Has that dynamic changed after its ending, or do you feel like it's been very consistent?
There hasn't been as many Bleach oriented panels, at least involving industry people. I know there's always fan panels at the
for sure.
Conventions. I haven't been asked to participate in any virtual convention panels that discussed Bleach in particular. It's more just general, like, oh, talk about voice acting. What are you?
Well, let's change that, everybody. Sort that out in the comment section. So let's
get on your social media and let the people who are organizing these online events, you know, what else are you going to do with your time? You got to stay home. And if you go out, you got to wear a mask. But
exactly. You got nothing better to do. Get on your PC and sort something out. Goddamn. And make sure that Carl's gets his role back, you know, as Aizen, you know. Not that he lost it, but make sure he gets it, you know. Otherwise, we riot.
Yeah. And that's funny that I like to say that, you know, voice actors are hired and fired all the time. We're not really fired per se, but they just don't need you anymore. Once the show's done.
Used and abused.
Yeah, it's like toss you to the side. Oh.
So yeah, I think I don't like all biasness aside, because you know I do love you as a person and as Aizen, but I cannot think of anyone better to play Aizen in the next upcoming season, or Ganju for that matter. So you know I think I speak for the Bleach fandom as well to say we will be very upset if you didn't.
Well.
And
thank
I think
you.
We're going to cause a revolution if you didn't, mate. So
yeah, it's always controversial if a cast because it doesn't come back, even in anime for dubs. There's a lot of controversy when Netflix licensed Neon Genesis Evangelion. They didn't want to use
that,
the original dub. And it's like, I felt so sorry for the cast of actors from the Houston area. And like, oh, that's sad. But
do you think that has anything to do with like licensing in particular, or just pure like they wasn't interested?
Yeah, it's just what, you know, if the client back in Japan kind of says, do what you want with the dub, we don't care, you know, it costs this much and then they license it. I mean, I don't know what happened behind the scenes. I just know that it's my understanding that they did not want to license the original dub. They went ahead and paid for, which was shocking, kind of. It's like, because dubs are expensive to produce.
Absolutely.
But, you know, on such an old title, that came out, what, in the mid-90s? But also another one of those influential titles that people probably hadn't seen
absolutely,
a lot.
Yeah.
And
absolutely.
Netflix and all these streaming services have really clamped onto that. And that's great. This is like the time to be an anime fan, to have the access to the most content legally you know, and
see, now I'm personally like on the fence with it, like because like on the other hand, it's like, yes, Netflix, sometimes they don't even go to the third party, they go straight to the studio and they get these shows, right? And they'll hire for dubbing, which is cool. The only thing that concerns me more so is like merchandise and Blu-ray box sets and DVD box sets for people to buy, which I don't think Netflix really give that option, do they?
No, merchandising rights is a whole different deal. Even though Netflix have put out some of their own stuff on DVD and Blu-ray, I kind of find that to be redundant because, you know, if it's a streaming platform, I mean, yeah, okay. You get a disc. The picture quality is going to be better because you're not dealing with internet bandwidth and all that. And there are...
I mean, look at vinyl. That came
back. Oh, totally, so, I mean, totally.
Yeah.
And I'm an old man. I'm 51, so I grew up on turntables, and then it transitioned to cassettes, and then compact disc, and then MP3s in the internet, and then now streaming, and like, vinyl's back, and... Okay, cool.
I think there's nothing better than holding something in your hand and say, I own this.
Exactly. Right? And with vinyl, it's an experience. And with physical media, for special things, like a niche thing like anime, they can take this opportunity and do something special for the fans. Things that you wouldn't get with a streaming platform, like a cool little keychain or an art booklet or posters and cool box packaging and whatnot. Of course, they get expensive, but it's more expensive to produce in limited quantities because so many more people in general just go with the convenience of streaming.
Oh, absolutely. It is convenience. And for me, I'm a very materialistic being when it comes to my anime and you know, figures and, well, some figures, yeah, but like merchandise in general, because I like to show that like I'm very passionate about my stuff and I want to support the industry in that way. I don't think it really needs it now, but like, hey, I'm still stuck in that mindset from 2010. So maybe that's just me.
That's okay because, you know, you've supported in the best way possible by getting official merchandise, supporting the shows by purchasing physical media. That's all that I would personally ask of any fan of any genre or TV or animation or games. Support it with your purchases because that is what sends a clear message to the industry. Mm-hmm. That, you know,
money talks.
Money makes the world go around. Money makes the machine churn out more stuff. If there's no money coming
you
in,
you want that season two of something?
Yeah, exactly.
Pay with your money. You know?
Yeah, think about this too. If there's a first world problem, now there's too much anime, right? There's so many series on Crunchyroll and all these others that it's hard to pick out the good stuff from, you know, the glut of
the bad.
For every 20 shows, there's one that might stand out, you know?
Might be a gem. Yeah, might be a gem.
Yeah, and you see, the studios are kind of, their solution to this is to, instead of making a full season of 26 episodes, they'll chop it in half and do like 11 or 12. And if that season does well, then they'll continue on. And that's smart, I think.
Yeah, absolutely.
I find it hard to say, I've never done this. I want to go back and start One Piece because, what is it, 900 episodes?
Oh, that's that took me a while.
I've done stuff throughout the years on that, you know, Capone and
Is it interesting for you to dub a character for a series, well, for a long-running series that you've never watched, essentially?
Mm-hmm. Well,
is it difficult?
It's always an honor to be a part of something that the audience connects with like that. And, you know, me as a performer, I want to do that character justice in
the best way possible. Right?
Yeah, that's icing on the cake, is to be told, we love your, you know, that helps drive your passion. It's like when someone likes what you do. And I got into voice acting, not for the accolades and not for money, definitely, because, yeah, voice actors aren't rich, not by and large, no.
As much as you'd like to believe, everyone.
Yeah, even the established ones are like, no, not driving Teslas and living in mansions. But
unfortunately,
as popular as anime is, you think we would, but the studios are profiting for far, far more than the production side of it.
They get a smidgen of the sense.
Little tiny piece of the pie.
That's it.
But at least it's there. I got into this because I've always wanted to do something that I love. And if I can get paid for it, that's life goals right there, you know? if it doesn't seem like work and you love what you do.
Exactly. So like, what was your first project? Was it a cartoon, a game, an anime? What was your first project?
The first one that I consider in voiceover was really Dragon Ball Z. I came from radio. I was a DJ on the radio first.
You got the voice for it, man.
Thank you. Yeah, I came from radio. A lot of DJs ended up trying out for Funimation at the time, and some went on to be used over and over again. My old on-air partner, Kara Edwards, who voices Goten and Videl in Dragon Ball Z.
Best girl.
Yeah, sorry, exactly. Sorry. Great Saiya girl. Yeah, yeah. She's been...
Childhood crush, mate. Childhood crush.
Aw, yeah, yeah.
Until they took away the pigtails and then I was very upset.
Right?
So degeneracy. I apologize. Carry on.
It's too funny, but I mean, I don't ever cosplay my characters, but she has. She has done her pigtails just like that and...
Brilliant.
Dressed up, it's like, well, that's easy. That's a cheap enough cosplay to do, you know? No fancy costume, really. But she has had a great degree of success, and I'm really happy for her. And she tells me that it's like, you helped me inspire me to want to follow voiceover. So she got out of radio, too, to follow this dream. And that's another one of those pay it forward things, you know? You feel good in influencing people, and not just entertaining them, but making them think. I like to say that actors are kind of therapists. You know, entertainment is therapy because it helps people.
Oh, absolutely.
Helps people
absolutely.
Escape from the real life troubles. You know, makes them forget, if only for a few minutes, and that makes a huge difference.
And then Twitter came along.
Wah, wah.
But no, you're completely right in saying that. Well, I won't say what do you prefer because I think the answer is pretty obvious. But like, I would say, would I say fulfillment? No, I don't think. I was going to say, in comparison to radio and acting, obviously they're two different ballparks.
Right.
Is there something that you miss out of radio in voice acting?
Sure.
Or vice versa?
Yeah, yeah. The live interaction with the audience, the positive pressure of planning four or five elements ahead. You know, while a song's playing on the air, you're thinking about what's the next song on the list, because that's all pre-programmed. Oh, spoiler alert, everything on the radio is pre-programmed, even when people request
Whoa.
It. What? Shocking.
My life is a lie.
Yeah, yeah. So we've got little cheat sheets of info that we can, you know, use in our breaks on the air. And I do miss that. I had such a blast. Mm-hmm. Me and Kara actually did work together with Radio Disney, which is still an online kids format. It's in the style of Top 40 or pop radio.
I would imagine it's more secure, too, as a career.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, this was another... career goal of mine when I was little. I was introvert. I was really shy. So I wanted to entertain.
Oh, same here.
I wanted to entertain, but I did not want to be seen. So I picked two things where I could entertain and not be seen.
Well, you are technically seen now.
I am.
To be honest. Yeah.
Yes. And the funny thing about voice acting is it gave me confidence. So I could address a panel room full of hundreds of people and not have a problem or be able to deal with interviews in person or online and just help come out of my shell. So it was a positive side effect from that, even though I'm still basically a very quiet guy and one of those things in any sort of freelance work.
You can turn it on and off though, right?
Yeah, yeah. Especially now when, I mean, people say, you got to stay home. It's like, I'm used to staying home. This is not a big deal to me.
I was born for this.
This is great. I don't have to socialize. But in this field, and I'm sure it's true of any freelance work, because it's not a 9-to-5 job. It's freelance. You have to market yourself. And you got to network and all that stuff. And it's like, oh, really? Do I have to go out there and meet people? And
so technically, you got to sell yourself.
You do. You are a brand.
Yeah, right.
You are a product. And
there you go, everyone. And anyone that's watching, hire Kyle because he's a good man, I think.
Well, think about social media, how controversial it is. There are people out there that absolutely hate, for various reasons, social media, Twitter, Facebook, and so forth. It's like, I don't want to tweet about, you know, what I had for lunch. And now it's become this ugly...
No, that's what Instagram is for.
Yeah. It's this ugly thing where it's political debates and controversy
absolutely.
And cyberbullying and all that. That's the underbelly. But the positive marketing aspect... It's free marketing.
Exactly. It's such a roller coaster of like pros and cons. That's the words I want to say. Yeah, pros and cons. So it's just a weird good, if that makes sense. Like, I mean, Facebook is more towards more close friends and family. LinkedIn is more connections. But Twitter is like everyone can talk. Everyone can share.
Yeah. And I saw a funny tweet from the official Twitter account going, "We'll add an edit button if everyone wears a mask."
Oh, yeah. Good luck with that.
Right?
Yeah, they knew. How do you even account for that? Imagine if they actually did, but oh, that'd be funny. A lot of controversies would stop, I think, with that edit button, but there you go.
There's so many people that do the screen capture of people that delete their tweets, and it's like, that me tweeted this! I'm like, oh.
What are you talking about? Like, it didn't say that. That's photoshopped. Edit.
Like, we'll put in small print, this post was edited. I'm like, what did he originally say?
Fucking damn it. Fuck. Right. Interestingly enough, because we spoke about streaming platforms, do you think Bleach will benefit from this hiatus? And what I mean by that, and I had to write on my question sheet, context is needed, James, because I didn't know how to write this. In essence, what I mean by this is if Bleach had carried on going from 2012, with streaming services becoming very prevalent, I believe anyway, in 2012, with like obviously Sword Art Online, Attack on Titan, Tokyo Ghoul becoming like opening up to the mainstream market. Do you think that if Bleach had carried on since 2012, do you think it will potentially have the same big boom that it will have now that anime has become more mainstream and streaming services have become more mainstream? Do you think Bleach actually benefited from this hiatus, or do you feel indifferent about it?
I do think a little time off is a good thing, because, you know, you can run something into the ground. If a show goes on too long and wears out its welcome or has too many filler arcs, you're going to turn off the fan base. I talk to a lot of people that have told me that, oh, Naruto has too many filler arcs. Bleach has too many filler arcs. Oh, filler.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I understand that. But I think the benefit is you're reaching a whole new audience now, and you can just say, hey, let's watch air quotes, classic anime, something that my parents watched or my older siblings watched, and they've tried to get me to watch it. And now it's like this, it's like a curation. It's like discovery. You know, you're trying to find bands on Spotify or Apple Music or wherever you're streaming music mm-hmm. from, and you discover new bands. I think that happens on streaming services, that you can see some interesting recommendations and try out something old and that's recommended, that it's like, okay, so there's 50,000 Magic Girl shows. I'm tired of Magic Girl shows. I want to watch some shonen stuff. Give me some classics. What do I need to do?
Is that a bit of projection?
No, not at all. As long as they hire me. I have been used on Sailor Moon. I have been Monster of the Week on Sailor Moon for years.
Oh, but that's the OG, though, so that's okay. That's the OG. You can't take that away.
Exactly.
That's what started it all, yeah.
Yeah, and I think a hiatus would be good. I think if Inuyasha came back, it would do great. I think, yeah.
Oh, it is. You know that, right?
I think I have heard that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I think it's a spin-off. I'm not quite sure what it is. Sequel, spin-off, something along those lines, as well as Shaman King.
Yeah.
Which is very interesting.
And Pokemon, that never went away, and it is showing no signs of loosening up.
Those games do be selling, man.
Hey, I didn't become a Pokemon fan until Pokemon Go, to be honest. I just, maybe I was too old for the the target audience, you know? It's like, I don't really get it. It's just repetitive. And
oh, so what's your excuse now? Huh?
I know. I've been playing Pokemon Go ever since it came out. And it's like, all right, this is great.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
I don't battle. I just collect.
Oh, wow. That's awesome. All I know is that they still play in Japan.
Yeah.
But, like, obviously the fad died off very quickly in the West.
So sure.
When I went over in 2018, they were still playing it, and I was very shocked, to be honest.
What I wish would happen over here is what, like, you get on a train or a public transportation system in Japan, and everyone's got their DS or their Switch.
Uh-huh.
And it's like, oh, that's cool.
It's beautiful. I love it.
I want the Street Pass to come to Switch. I like that,
uh-huh.
Collecting those things. I loved doing that, even though I would never meet half of these people. I would suddenly, boom, it would pop up. It's like, okay.
Just a sense of gratification.
Collect
really,
those little pieces of the puzzle and the world map. And it's like, dude, I've been able to travel the world because of conventions and been able to collect little things. So like, oh, cool. Cool, I got one from Japan.
And you can sell it on eBay afterwards.
You sell it on eBay. Some people say that. Yeah. It's like, I picked up some extra Gohan Dragon Ball Super Pops and even the limited version, just in case.
Yeah, exactly, right? Brilliant. Because I know a lot of Dragon Ball pops had sold out very quickly, yes. And they were limited editions. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I saw them going for mad prices on eBay. Extremely ridiculous.
And can I say, I've been bummed that with all the Bleach ones came out, there was no Aizen. It's like, ooh. How come the villain, who typically is gets more love, didn't get a lot of love in the merch world? I mean, he has a plushie, but...
Ironically, right?
Yeah.
Ironically, it's... Bleach merch has been extremely, how do I say, improperly done in the West, I believe. I've had many a tangents about it, but yeah, I'm hoping for a huge resurgence, to say the least.
What I was hoping would come over is that they would port all these PSP Bleach fighting games that were never released in America. And
I think there's only three, right, that need to be localized?
Yeah, Soul Resurrection and a couple of DS titles.
No, that was the PlayStation 3 game. It was the Heat the Soul games that were the PSP ones, I think.
Oh, yeah. And I got
Soul
one.
Soul Carnival, that's what you're thinking of.
I mean, Carnival. I got one that had English menus on it, and I could play, you know, I don't think PSP was region locked, so you could play any game from all over the world, and I got that, and it's like, why is this coming out? I guess because the Wii Bleach game didn't do well.
Oh, yeah.
They look at those sales figures. So I was actually kind of shocked that Soul Resurrection actually was a thing.
It's so weird to me, because I think, Soul Ignition or Soul Resurrection, what they called it in the West, was it did bad, to say the least, on PlayStation 3. Mm. And because of how bad that did, they just stopped. And I'm like, really? After all these PSP games that actually did quite well, maybe not Wii, but you chose Soul Resurrection when you didn't even market the game? Like, okay.
Yeah.
Cool. Brilliant.
Meanwhile, Naruto and Dragon Ball continue to bring, you know, Clash of Ninja and Budokai and Tenkaichi and Burst Limit. I mean, they kept going with Dragon Ball. Maybe that's just because they're an exception, but they kept going after Sagas, which was an awful, awful Dragon Ball game on Xbox, the original Xbox. Oh, that hurt.
Do you know what? I loved Burst Limit. Was it Burst Limit? Yeah, the really high def one for PS3.
Yeah.
That was a banger, but it had no content on it.
Yeah.
And I was hoping they would always do a sequel to that, unfortunately.
Yeah. They didn't. I mean, my favorite games have been either the original Budokais or FighterZ, you know, the one from last
year. FighterZ, okay. Not the new Kakarot?
I haven't tried it yet. I got like a free download code from Funimation. I'm not really an RPG guy. I'm not like, I'm going to walk around and explore. It's like, it's not really my kind of gaming experience. I love being able to fight, shoot, jump, race, those instant gratification things. And I'm a button masher. I'm not a great gamer.
Oh, absolutely. Games. Absolutely. That's me.
Yeah.
In every game. This is a rhythm game, James. No, I'm just hitting random drum beats. I love it.
Yeah, dude. Funimation just had their con this weekend, and I was up against Rappa. I was Fat Gum versus Rappa, and Kenny Omega, the wrestler, was the commentator during the match. And I was like, oh my God, I was fanboying out because I'm a huge AEW wrestling fan. And this was so much fun. My Hero Academia we were playing My Hero One's Justice 2, which has an English dub on it. That shocked the fan base because the original did not have that.
What? Yeah, I did hear about that.
And another one that I think, I mean, maybe because he didn't come along till late in the game, but it's like, come on, let's make a pop figure of Fat Gum and have him be huge, like actual scale size to the other ones.
Scale size, right? Yeah. Life size more so. No.
And Ox King, because I voiced Ox King too back in the day.
Oh, Ox King, yeah. That's a banger.
Oh, boy.
That's a show.
Yeah, let's make one.
Oh, wow. You throw me off, man. You throw me off.
It's what I do. It's what I do. It's like, what questions? Just throw it out the window.
Yeah, just do this for the entire video. Fuck it, we'll get views.
edit. But what about Bleach? I'm like, sorry.
What? What's that series again? What? That's been dead for 7 years. Fuck. Yeah, get rehearsing on that, mate.
Right. Yeah. Believe me, voice actors talk to themselves all the time.
I would imagine a lot of actors read the manga before a series comes out, and they're just like practicing lines beforehand before they actually get the script.
Oh,
it's how I've always envisioned
it. Now, believe it or not, we don't get the scripts ahead of time. We don't get the footage ahead of time. Because honestly, time is money, and they don't have money in the budget to pay us to sit there and do research and practice and rehearse and all that. So we go in cold. Yeah. And nowadays with COVID, everyone's recording from home. We've had to upgrade our home studios to meet broadcast quality. So yeah, the first time I see the scene or the line is in the session. We'll preview each line in Japanese, and then they'll direct me. It's like, here, make it a little faster, a little short, and you got to match the lip sync and all that. And I record on my end. They record on their end. We use a program called Source Connect. There are other programs out there that digitally connect, so you get studio quality on both sides. So the engineer's recording, the director is directing over Skype or something, and we're using Skype or Zoom to look at the video. And the engineer places it and makes sure the sync works. And
what about in terms of like simuldub?
Same process. There's just a quicker turnaround.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Stuff like, you know, Pokemon Masters is the latest thing that came out that I was on, and that was recorded only a couple months ago, and that's already turned around on Netflix. So it just depends on the project and where it goes. The simuldubs with Funimation, obviously the turnaround time, it becomes a little more difficult, because any engineer will tell you now, in the wake of this pandemic, their work is harder because you're recording all these different actors from different microphones from different places. You got to mix it all together and make it sound as if it were all done in one place. And they're tearing their hair out. They're like, oh my god, I can't wait for this COVID to go away so people can go back into the studio and all that. Meanwhile, a lot of actors, we miss seeing each other obviously in person and all that, but I am spoiled by being able to roll out of bed, go into my walk-in closet here and record. It's like being your PJs.
It was always fascinating to me how you guys didn't actually do the same process that the Japanese do, because they all, most of the cast stay in the same booth, don't they? And they just like bounce off each other.
They do.
From line to line, right?
And for cartoons, they still do that because the animation's not done yet. But they dub their own. They dub their own anime in Japan. The animation's done first, and then they come in as a cast. And you know, if you watch shows in Japanese, you'll notice the lip sync isn't 100% dead on. And culturally, that throws us off. You know, it's like watching an old Godzilla or Bruce Lee movie. It's like it just becomes funny. The lip sync's off.
Yeah.
So there's a very concerted effort when the writers are adapting the Japanese scripts into English. They sit there and watch each frame of the video and make sure that what they're writing will fit the flaps. And sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it's overwritten or underwritten. And sometimes we got to make it slightly different during the session. It's an interesting process. And, you know,
But we would never notice, because like either watch the dub or we watch the sub. So, and we'd be reading the subtitles. So we wouldn't even be focusing on mouth movements.
Oh, yeah. If you want to really get thrown for a loop, watch the dub and have subtitles on. You'll notice that they're different.
Oh, that's a banger. That's a banger, that is. I've seen some funny memes from that.
Yeah, yeah. And I'll me and my wife will watch some.
Evangelion was actually a good example of
that. That's true. But I was gonna say, me and my wife have watched like live action shows that are you know, Asian movies or Korean or whatever,
and they're dubbed,
and
over,
they're dubbed into English. And then I've had
the Bleach live action movie actually.
That's right. I don't know if those will ever get adapted into English. Of course, I hear they're really bad.
No, they have. Yeah, yeah. Johnny did it.
Okay.
Yeah, it's actually really good.
Is it?
Surprisingly. Yeah.
Hearing that in the same sentence really is not common.
Right? Live action, good, huh?
Yeah. Like, there's always one in the room that goes, Rurouni Kenshin was good. And I'm like, okay, all right, well.
Like, is that
everything
it?
Else.
Yeah, okay, cool.
Everything else
is. But I went to Japan for that. It was May. Was it May? No, July. What am I talking about? Yeah, July 2018. I went there. There was a massive heat wave and a typhoon, but I still went to that cinema to go watch it. It was amazing. And then I heard it was coming to Netflix, and I was like, oh, okay. Wasted my time. Not totally, but I was not in a rush. Yeah, I watched the dub, and I was like, this is pretty awesome, to be fair.
Yeah, to be fair. And Japan, they had an IMAX version of the Broly movie. That should have come out.
I was so annoyed to hear that that wasn't happening. We didn't get that in the UK. Actually, we might have had it in the UK. Might have, but it was very limited.
Yeah, just a handful of theatrical screenings, but they sold out. They had to add more screenings.
Which is weird to me. It's like, if something's going to sell, just keep it up.
You'd think.
What are you doing?
You'd think.
Yeah, you think, right?
Jeez. In the old days, it cost, a few grand to make a film print, you know, film projectors, but now everything's digital. So just slap in the hard drive. Yeah, unless you're Quentin Tarantino, you know, a film purist, everything has gone digital. And this is all, believe it or not, thanks to George Lucas pushing for it. When he shot those prequels for Star Wars, he wanted it to go all digital. And back then, everyone was all analog. Everyone was film projectors. Like, oh, it's too expensive to upgrade. Now look at us. We're all digital.
Yeah, exactly. It takes one thing.
Yep.
Your character, Aizen, did you expect him to be as popular as you did?
I didn't, because he doesn't actually have all that much screen time, all in all. He is more like in the background, you know, scheming and sitting on his pimp throne and stuff. And it's like, I thought when they told me, it's like, all right, you're Aizen, you're the villain. I said, oh, I'm going to have so much to do. And
Hang on a second. Just to get this out there, because the comments, I think, will find that funny. The fact that you said pimp throne is going to be such a meme for what you're going to see when you do your lines, mate. That's what I'm going to say. Yeah,
it's his pimp throne. It's like,
maybe you don't read the comments of the video for that spoiler.
Yeah. And when I got the role, I thought I was going to have so much to do. I'm going to have so much dialogue and scenery chewing and all that. And it turned out not so much to be the case. It's like, he's calm 99% of the time. Which is easy.
But did you like his monologues, right? I do. He had some really cool monologues and ideologies, essentially.
Absolutely. And I like the whole butterflies, and I enjoyed that transformation.
Oh, it's such a weird one.
It is weird.
I don't know if I like it, but that's the point, right? It's supposed to be mythological or angelic in a weird sense.
Yeah. You watch it one time and you go, okay, that's weird. I'm a little off-put. That's a little strange. And then you kind of just come to terms with it. And it's like, oh, okay. All right. What I like to say is, oh, Japan, or oh, anime. It's like, whatever,
yeah,
they
exactly,
throw you a kink,
right?
and like, what are they doing with this plot? What is this? Oh my God. Okay.
Don't worry about it. Just watch it. Just go with the flow.
Just turn your brain off and accept
just
it.
Just accept it.
It's good.
Shh, go with the flow.
Quiet. Yes.
So when did you begin to notice this popularity, would you say?
Well, immediately as I was continuing to go on the convention scene, so many people were saying, oh my God, I'm a huge Bleach fan. Aizen's the best, or Aizen's the worst. I love to hate him, or I hate to love him, or all this stuff. And a large female contingency. A lot of girls really, really, really dig him.
Well, I think we can both see why.
He's a stud. Yeah. And he goes from Clark Kent to Superman, you know, takes them glasses off and
exactly
has that mullet.
Well, did the
of
glasses
doom.
Even exist in the first place?
Yeah.
Did they even exist? It really makes you think.
I think he looks cooler with the long hair, by the way. I think, yeah, definitely.
Oh, absolutely. Did Momo deserve it?
I guess for his purposes, yeah.
There was one question that I had. I was like, I'm not going to ask him, but fuck it. They were like, do you think stabbing Momo gave us some well-needed character development?
Well, I think that action in and of itself is character development. It's like, oh, we love this guy because he's so nice and sweet and nurturing and evil. Oh, my God. You know.
And then Stockholm Syndrome kicked in.
Oh, totally. Totally. Yes.
Great character development. Hey, she got penetrate for free, so, you know, what can you
That's
say?
That's right. Here, be a pinata or be a beep, voodoo doll.
Exactly. I love it. Oh, he's such an arsehole. It's great. it's great. I was going to ask this for later on in the series, but what was your favorite role in the series to play? Like, was there a specific scene that comes to mind where you're like, yeah, this is the dog's bollocks?
I loved the monologue when he reveals his true self. You know, he hasn't taken the glasses off yet. Mm. And it's like, that is pivotal. That is like, what? I mean, it shocks so many people that, like, what?
When he's in that light beam and he's
yeah.
like, throwing him up to yeah oh, sorry,
yeah
shit. And then he talks about James, don't spoilers, god damn it.
I will stand atop the heavens. I love that moment too.
That's relevant, basically.
Yeah.
That's relevant.
Yeah.
You're gonna have fun. You're gonna have a lot of fun. I can't wait to see your reaction. Hopefully you talk about it on social media when it airs, or when it happens in Japan, or when it happens in dub. I can't wait to see your reaction to it. It will be amazing. I'm just very fucking excited, mate, to be honest.
And I'm sure, you know, even if it doesn't get dubbed, it's going to get out there. The audiences are going to see it, and
oh, it's going to get dubbed, man. We're going to speak out, man, and we're going to have a hissy fit.
Yeah.
We'll make it happen.
Yeah. Well, use the power of social media. They will listen to the fans, or else the fans revolt. Exactly. They go crazy if they don't get what they want.
Right? Exactly. It's happening. Whether companies like it or not, we'll make it happen. God damn it.
I mean, they did well enough to continue to issue out the box set or the season sets. So, you know.
Oh, well, I truly believe that was a Shueisha marketing, you do this, guys, personally. But I do love the quality of them. I think they're amazing.
Yeah. Again, it's better than streaming. There's an uptick in quality.
I assume you don't get any commission off that.
No, there's no residuals in anime, unfortunately.
Unfortunately.
If it were a cartoon like The Simpsons or Family Guy, then yeah, there's residuals from sales. The only thing I get residuals from is Wreck-It Ralph and Wreck-It Ralph 2, because I had a Ryu Street Fighter moment in both movies.
That's
so
cool.
I get some kickback.
Yeah,
I watched that.
It was great.
Sure you can. Hadouken! Yes. The answer lies in the heart of battle. So this is Smash.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
This is beautiful. I love it. you've blasted through all my questions, lad. I'm surprised,
oh,
to be honest
booyah,
with you.
Yeah,
that's
booyah.
Great.
I've done a few interviews in my time, so in 20 years, yeah.
Oh, yeah. You just, I'm sociably awkward, so you just like carried it for me. It was like, thanks, mate. You did half my job for me. It's great.
It's all
right. There was one last request, and you can refuse this one,
okay,
because there is no context, because
right,
it is, it's a line,
yes,
from the manga, right? Okay. So I will say, the line is, "Welcome to my soul society," and it's said within a smug voice.
Welcome to my soul society.
There you go, people. Kyle, everyone, please go follow him on Twitter and YouTube. And do you have Instagram?
I do, at Kyle Hebert. And that last name is spelled not Herbert, but H-E-B-E-R-T. It's a Louisiana French name. But at Kyle Hebert on Twitter and Instagram, same hashtag.
Multicultural, you got to love it. There you go. And is there anything you want to plug as well while you're here? Anything you're doing, any projects?
Just check my social media. I'm on stuff that I can't talk about yet. But as soon,
ooh,
as I get the okay, or it's released out into the world, I will tweet from the highest mountain.
There you go, everybody. Yeah, go show him some love. And I appreciate having you on.
Thank you. Thank you. It's great to be here. I appreciate it.
Take it easy. I'm going to catch you motherfuckers later. You guys, of course, have this fine day. I've been Hanson. And as always, people, peace out.
Peace.